Greetings, fellow nerds. In this video, we're going to explore the science of flameless ration heaters and other self-heating food containers. Now, if you're like most of humanity, you like cooked food, or at least hot food. Most of it is prepared using stoves, microwaves, ovens, and so on. But sometimes for camping or highly mobile individuals like military personnel, civilians in disasters, or even just truckers and students who want instant meal, it's more convenient to somehow heat the food using a portable device. Systems using flames are very common and used often, but there is some demand for completely flameless systems for reduced fire hazard and ease of use. Portable electric cookers and heaters are very popular but require electricity, which isn't always available, especially in a disaster. So something self-contained with a long shelf life is desired. Flameless ration heaters and similar water-activated food heaters were created to meet the demand. The concept is simple. The heater is in a bag and the food package is inserted. Water is added to activate the heater and heats up to near boiling, allowing the food to be warmed. So what's actually happening in them on a chemical level? I'm going to explain by actually making one. There are just two things. The most important ingredient is this magnesium iron alloy powder. It contains about 95% magnesium and 5% iron. The next ingredient is salt, sodium chloride. And that's it. In the dry state, this is quite stable and can last for decades. To activate it, water is added. And there we go. A tremendous amount of heat is produced, enough to get the water boiling. During actual usage, there is a food package immersed in the water to absorb the heat. So what's happening is the magnesium iron alloy forms a tiny little galvanic cell in the salt water. The magnesium dissolves and releases electrons that go over to the iron particles where they electrolyze water and release hydrogen. The result is magnesium hydroxide. If any of you have shorted out a battery and felt it get hot or even burst into flames, a similar thing is happening here. The conversion of magnesium to magnesium hydroxide produces a tremendous amount of heat, and we can boil water with just a tenth of its mass worth of chemicals. Those of you familiar with magnesium chemistry are probably asking, can this be done with just magnesium alone? The answer is the magnesium does react with water, but without the iron, the reaction is just too slow. While magnesium might dissolve easily, the overpotential for hydrogen formation is too slow and limits how fast the reaction proceeds. So iron is used with its very good kinetics and low hydrogen overpotential to quickly release hydrogen and make the reaction proceed faster. So now that we know how it works, can we make our own? Unfortunately, that isn't very easy. This magnesium iron alloy was very hard to get. I had to special order it, so it was not amateur accessible. I did try and make a heater anyway using normal magnesium turnings, salt, and iron powder. Unfortunately, it did not really work. The iron needs to be in contact with the magnesium, and if it's free floating, it'll quickly disconnect as hydrogen agitates it. Now, before you say the iron is floating and not in contact with the magnesium, only a small amount is floating. It's hard to see, but a lot of it did sink and mix with the magnesium. Here is another run where you can see the mixing better. I ran several tests, but I still wasn't able to get it to work. I could boost it with a little hydrochloric acid, but ultimately the performance just wasn't good enough as a heater. We need that special magnesium iron alloy. We could make it, but that's a lot of work for something that's supposed to be very cheap. But that doesn't mean we do nothing. There are hundreds of amateur accessible and extremely exothermic reactions we could select from to make our own flameless ration heater. Of course, we're not going to use thermite to cook our food, and that's not exactly safe. The most obvious method is to use magnesium turnings, which are much easier to get than magnesium iron alloy, and instead of using salt and iron, we use sodium bisulfate, a pH-lowering chemical for swimming pools. Magnesium dissolves in acid very easily and very quickly. I'm using 7 grams of magnesium and 40 grams of sodium bisulfate. Now we add 50 milliliters of water to activate it, and that was a little too active. I can see why commercial units do not use this reaction. It does work, but it's a little too much. We can slow down the reaction a bit by first putting the sodium bisulfate in a coffee filter or other porous package. This will slow down the mixing and control the reaction better. Let me add the water, and indeed it's a lot slower, but it does work. The sodium bisulfate has to dissolve first, diffuse out of the coffee filter, and then react with the magnesium. Okay, I'm going to assemble it into a Ziploc bag, and here is our homemade flameless ration heater. All we gotta do is add water. And there it goes. Oh, I forgot to mention how the chemistry works. What's happening is simply the magnesium reacts with the sodium bisulfate to make magnesium sulfate, sodium sulfate, and hydrogen gas. Magnesium reacts very quickly with acid, so you don't need to help it with iron. And our homemade heater seems to work, although some of the magnesium floats up on top of the coffee filter bag, so we need to shake it down. Maybe this can be improved with a tea bag, or maybe even just crystallizing the sodium bisulfate into a solid block that dissolves slower than powder. No need for a bag, and it'll mix just fine. But we don't even have to put in that much work. There is another amateur accessible reaction, and that's the reaction of sodium hydroxide with aluminum. I have here 10 grams of sodium hydroxide, which is available in some brands of drain cleaner, and to this we add 5 grams of aluminum foil. We crumple it up to slow down the reaction rate, and that is our flameless ration heater. To activate it, we add 50 milliliters of water. And there it goes, producing a tremendous amount of heat. What's happening is the sodium hydroxide reacts with aluminum and water to produce sodium aluminate and hydrogen gas. This is a simple but extremely exothermic reaction. A few brands of flameless ration heater actually do use this reaction, but the magnesium iron alloy version is more popular. The big reason is that this reaction is corrosive toward aluminum pans and cookware, so you need all plastic or iron cookware. Since a few types of portable meals or food rations are packaged in aluminum trays, this heater cannot be used because it'll eat through the tray and contaminate the food. You do not want to be eating drain cleaner. So the magnesium iron alloy version is more popular. Also, sodium hydroxide is somewhat caustic to human skin. It is drain cleaner after all. So you need to wash your hands if you accidentally get it on you. This is not a problem with magnesium iron alloy heaters. While not good to eat, the magnesium hydroxide isn't nearly as bad or corrosive. Nonetheless, as long as you're careful, this can be used. I'm sure some of you campers or extreme emergency preppers would appreciate being able to make your own flameless ration heater. So if you want to assemble this into a proper bag, we just pre-weigh and seal 10 grams of sodium hydroxide in an airtight bag and alongside it store a 5 gram folded up strip of aluminum foil. For large meals, you may want more and can scale up the ratio as long as you have 2 parts sodium hydroxide for every 1 part aluminum by mass. Do not store them together in the same bag, as even in the dry state, sodium hydroxide will slowly corrode the aluminum and consume it. So it's best to keep them separate until use. To use them, just put the aluminum foil into the bag and add about 4 to 5 times the mass of water. Since the total mass of the chemicals is 15 grams, I'm adding in 60 milliliters of water. And there it goes. Of course, during actual use, you would also put in a food bag containing whatever rations or meals you'll need to heat up. Now I have to mention that this can get hot enough to rupture these flimsy Ziploc bags. It only happened a couple of times during the dozens of tests I tried, but I thought I should mention it. Try and find some stronger and thicker bags, double up the bags, or experiment with different containers before using these in the field. My friends that have tried this say putting paper liners in the bags helps to protect them, but I haven't been able to test it myself. Anyway, another chemistry we can try is aluminum foil and calcium hydroxide. This is sold as slaked lime for making water as well as for culinary purposes. You can also use calcium oxide or quicklime. Anyway, the water is added and just like the reaction with sodium hydroxide, the calcium hydroxide reacts with the aluminum to form various calcium aluminates. The product is rather poorly defined with a mixture of different products, so I'm just giving one answer here. And there it goes. I'm not sure what would be easier to get for you, calcium hydroxide or sodium hydroxide, but at least you have options. Aluminum metal is quite reactive with strong bases. This chemistry is found in a few commercial brands of flameless ration heaters. But just like the sodium hydroxide version, it is corrosive to aluminum and so it's not as popular as the magnesium iron alloy version. Okay, so let's assemble it into a heater. We just lay out 5 grams or so of aluminum foil, the exact size doesn't matter, and spread out 20 to 30 grams of calcium hydroxide or oxide. Then we fold it over to make a flat roll. Now we put it in our bag and cut it up to ensure that water can get in. And that's it. The great advantage of this type over the sodium hydroxide type is that you don't need to store the foil from the calcium hydroxide separately. To use it, we just add 75 milliliters of water. The point of spreading it out and rolling it up is so that the calcium hydroxide is spread out enough to be in contact with the aluminum foil. Commercial devices use aluminum powder, which works much better. Unfortunately, because we're using aluminum foil and calcium hydroxide, startup is very slow. This took a good 20 minutes to get going, while the other systems reached peak temperature in just 5 minutes. If you can get aluminum powder and or calcium oxide, those two improvements would greatly improve the speed. Nonetheless, this does work if you're very patient. Now, a slight problem with all these heaters so far is that they all generate hydrogen gas. This is not good for enclosed spaces. The danger of an explosion is quite small as the amount of hydrogen produced is very small, but it nonetheless means it can't be used for everything. Now, I've been asked, can the hydrogen itself be ignited and burned or used in a catalytic burner for extra heat? It could, but such a system would cost more than the heater itself. Might as well just use extra chemicals for less cost. Additionally, the point of these things is to be flameless, and that's a requirement for certain applications. If flames are acceptable, then it's cheaper and more effective to use fueled cookers and burners like charcoal, butane, or propane. Anyway, we're still stuck with the hydrogen issue. The containers must be allowed to vent as they operate, and this means they can spill if tipped over. So self-heating foods like coffee cans need something different that can be safely tipped. It's not fun drinking coffee from a container you're not allowed to tip. For those systems, a calcium oxide is used. I made mine by simply heating calcium hydroxide in a furnace to 700 Celsius for a few hours. The calcium oxide reacts with water to produce calcium hydroxide and a small amount of heat is released. The big advantage of this is that it's completely contained and produces no gas. So it can be used in completely sealed containers like the bottom of a self-heating coffee can. The big disadvantage is that the amount of heat is small. So you need a lot more calcium oxide to sufficiently heat something. Sometimes the volume matches or exceeds the food itself. This severe weight penalty is rather inconvenient and is why calcium oxide-based food heaters are rather rare and usually limited to self-heating foods that must be sealed. Personally, I am going to use my aluminum and sodium hydroxide-based heater for the occasional power outage emergency, as I already have these chemicals and can quickly whip them up in just a few minutes. Aluminum foil and drain cleaner are not hard to find, and I prefer to keep my magnesium for amateur chemistry. Now, those of you might be wondering, can you use aluminum metal with sodium bisulfate? I actually tried to do that, but the reaction was too slow. I did see bubbles of hydrogen forming, but it never got warm enough to be useful. Another note before I go, if you don't want to immerse your food package into a bag of chemicals, or if your food is not waterproof, like my lunch in this paper bag, an alternate heating method is to put the food next to the heater rather than in it, and use containers like this cardboard box to confine and insulate it. You can even use two heaters to make up for the heat loss since they are so cheap and easy to make. Some MRE food boxes with built-in heaters use a similar setup to heat up a whole box worth of food. I think the absolute highest level of MRE technology explicitly and specifically commands the use of a rock or something. I do not question the methods of those who are braver and harder working than I. Anyway, looks like one of mine didn't mix well. Let me shake it up. And there it goes. So anyway, that's how self-heating foods and flameless ration heaters work to generate heat without flames, and how we can make them ourselves. While a kitchen with a stove is orders of magnitude better and more useful, if you're out camping, in combat, in a disaster, or simply on the road, this might be a viable way to heat food so you have something warm to eat. Thanks for watching! Special thank you to all of my supporters on Patreon for making these science videos possible with their donations and their direction. If you're not currently a patron but would like to support the continued production of science videos like this one, then check out my Patreon page here or in the video description. I really appreciate any and all support.